Hi, it's Bob Kraft of tennisministry.org, and I'm glad to be able to talk to you today. I'm bringing you a topic on the pro tennis players during the past decade and my experiences. Back in 2002, when I first started really full-time, I started back in the early 90s, and I met a lot of players like Sampras and Agassi, people like that. But 2002 was when I really started to put my full heart into it, my full time. And the player that at the French Open that were coming up, Anastasiya Myskina, and she won the tournament, the French Open. And you know, I didn't really know the players, especially if they were clay court players, because I came from hard courts, the U.S. at that time, and the clay court players weren't that well known in the U.S. But you know, I got to know these players, and there were some men players who won the tournament that year, and they, you know, were on the scene for a year or two. They were very famous on clay courts in the world, but in my world, they weren't that well known. And but I got to know them. And Anastasiya, I got to know her. Her coach was from Stuttgart, Germany, and I had lived in Stuttgart, and I said hello to him. We just said hello to each other, became friendly to each other, but we weren't great friends. But we were kind to each other. Anastasiya didn't really know who I was. I was new on the scene, but no one really knew who she was because she came and won the tournament totally unexpected, and no one expected her to win that Grand Slam final. She had a cross, and I spoke to her about that, and turned out she was a Christian. But you know, I said, "Does it mean anything to you?" Let me rephrase that, okay? I want to clarify that. I said, "Does this mean anything to you?" And she said, "No, it doesn't. I just jewelry." So she wasn't a Christian. I want to clarify that. But, you know, I was looking for ways to speak to her. And obviously she came from Russia, Moscow. She was, if she had any church background at all, it might have been through the Orthodox Church. So, you know, what did stand out, what I learned from that, was that when she won the tournament, she was the darling. She was on all the magazines, in the press. You know, everybody said she's going to be... She ended up number one in the world for a brief period of time because of her ranking points. And, you know, she's on top of the world. There weren't that many Russian players that were number one in the world before 2002. She said, "I want to." She told me, "I want to take my prize money, and I want to." Her idea was she was going to be number one for a long time. She was going to make a lot of money from tennis, and that she said she wanted to use her prize money for orphanages because she had a heart for orphanages in her country, children without parents. And you know, I was very new at the game at that time. I didn't know too much about the pro tour. What happened was what I learned from it. Was that she was number one just for a very, very brief period of time, and she disappeared. I mean, within a matter of a year to a year and a half, she was struggling to even play tennis, and she quit shortly thereafter the game. So here's someone who'd been all this adulation, and I saw it firsthand, and the agents chasing her, all of a sudden nobody wanted to talk to her, and she wasn't even on the pro tour. She never came back. And, you know, it's kind of like, everything we work for and everything we assume that things are going to be a certain way, but then they don't turn out that way, even if you're at the top of the world. And the good news about this is through Facebook and some other things, I'm thinking maybe she accepted Christ because I've seen some things where she's talked about her faith in the media. And that's not something she did before. I'm praying that she had that relationship with that encounter with Christ face to face. Her coach, who had then moved on, they were a boyfriend and girlfriend at that time while he was coaching her. He then moved on, and he actually has told me that he accepted Christ. He went and taught in England, and now I'm not sure where he's at. And he and I had fellowship a brief period of time when I saw him at a tournament many years later. And so I think that's fabulous. I'm praying that he will grow and that he'll find a good home church. But these are all things that this is the reality of of life on the pro tour. And, you know, sometimes we think that we have a goal to be the best, and we maybe even are the best, but things aren't, we can live in a make-believe world in our head as to what the world is going to be like, and we can create it. We can seemingly create it, but actually it's not that way. What goes on sometimes is out of our control, and you have to be prepared to handle that in your own life. And having a good solid rock, which is a faith in Jesus Christ, which never changes, is the rock of salvation. That is so helpful during the highs and lows of your life.